you said this quickly. Yeah, I was talking about this.
Okay. So yeah, now that we're mostly visible, I was talking about this upper left corner here and showing how you can edit the widget and add, easily add an image and a table and some information. And I can write anything I want here, you know, basically. In fact, that's not a bad idea for if you wanted to create a highlighted news post that, you know, you're constantly changing just to always have an upper left corner. That would be something pretty simple as well. The only problem with doing news posts that way is you're deleting the previous post every time you're
updating. Right.
So that's one of the benefits of using this news, you know, the actual news widget. So the other thing I did want to talk about was the news widget itself. I want to start down here at the bottom with the first post of the news here, and basically just talk about the fact that you can, if you don't know this, dynamically insert your student's first name in the post. And that's simply done, if I edit this, you'll see that it's done by hello, and then curly brings in the first name. And that will actually put their name into the post. And a lot of students actually have asked me, how do you like write posts for every student?
Is there, you could do that for any widget, right? You just, or how does that, can you cover, because I remember the DL person covering that, and I remember.
You don't have anything else that works in any widget.
And is that like a set of fields, like first name, last name?
Yeah, there's, if you Google it, there's documentation on it. Okay. There's not a whole lot of them. I would really like to, I think in D2L there's a way to insert your nickname or the name you prefer to be used.
Okay.
I wish there was one for that because, I mean, mine's a fellow Timothy.
Right.
I don't know that kind of thing, so, you know.
That gives away as a form thing.
Yeah.
I see.
You could, you know, kind of personalize that a little further. The other thing, let's see. The other thing I wanted to talk about is also, and this is one thing that gets a little away from basic knowledge of using D2L, but if you're familiar with HTML and cascading style sheets or styles a little bit, which I definitely, if you're going to continue online teaching, I recommend at least becoming familiar enough so you can be comfortable looking at the code. You know, it doesn't mean that you have to actually know how to edit it and create
just like basic HTML tags,
yeah,
or other.
Yeah, and that's how I created this little like call out, you know, with the yellow background. If I go into here,
well, what do you mean? You can do that. What do you mean you've created it through? You could do that just with the what they have there.
Well, they don't have a.
They don't actually have a highlighting thing.
Yet.
Oh, okay. So, okay. Thanks.
So the way I did this is really difficult to see the way they format this, but I'll break it out here. So I basically just put this in a div, which is an HTML tag that says style equals background. Actually, I'll just put it on. Wow, see, sometimes D2L changes things, too.
Mm-hmm.
Let me show you how I did this, and then you can look a lot simpler. So,
is that how you did the, is that how you did the first name thing, too, or does that not have to be in the HTML?
No, that doesn't, that's
okay.
Yeah, you can type that
that's
just a little bit. So this is, all right, so this is how I created it. I said this style background, and then I gave it a hex value, which you can get in an image editing application or something, but basically just a six letter and number widget that is called. And so I put that around the text, and that's what created that yellow bar. So, you know, I mean, little things like that. If I ever have an important date or something that's in a news post and I don't want them just to like brush through it and not see it, I'll do something like that. The second thing is this other news post. And I just kind of, this is a real basic sort of fact about dynamic web publishing, keeping your audience engaged and things like that, but post regular, relevant, and meaningful news posts. And this is something I try to do, I only do it with my truly online classes, the hybrid or on-ground classes. I will, you know, give them news and things in class, but I don't really feel like I need to do this. But I'm always finding news and posting it in the middle section for them to look at, and I will always do it with an image. And so if there's an image that relates to the post or if it's from the news post that I'm linking them to, I will get an image and actually post it into the news post. Now, here's a couple of tips that I wrote in here as well. Take some time to learn basic Photoshop or any image editing application for that matter, so you can resize images appropriately for ease of viewing and file size. One thing that I find that a lot of students do, and I'm assuming that instructors will do it as well, is find a really great image that's like, you know, 1024 by 768, put it in their post and then like manually resize it. And really all that does is make it smaller and make the image have less quality. Mm-hmm. But the file size is the same, and every time someone loads the page, it's going to take a long time to load. So just knowing how to resize an image in Photoshop or some other application is really helpful. Of course, always make sure to include appropriate alt tags when uploading your photos so that you can comply with ADA recommendations. And that's something that I've tried to take care of ever since we started talking about this. There's still some areas that I've probably forgotten to update, but I really try to. And if you hover your mouse over it, you'll see that. I mean, all I do is beautify your news posts. Use basic formatting tools like centering images, which is really simple. I'll go through some that also in a second. And then, of course, a little HTML and CSS will allow you to do things like place borders around the images as well. So that's something that I did here. So I'm going to go to edit this post. Just show you that you can click on a post or on an image, and you can just use your basic center, right, you know, justify buttons to put those in different places.
Do you ever have trouble if you try to do two next to each other? Because I had a problem with that.
There's an issue with what are called CSS quotes and anything that kind of stuff. So I try to space it instead of if I'm not using trickery, you know.
Okay.
So yeah. Another thing I did here is this image actually has a number of, right here. You'll see it has style, border, and all of this. This is stuff for someone with a little more knowledge of, you know, how to create CSS tags and things like that. But that's what put that border around the image. And you'll see how that works in some of my content as well. So that's really some of the stuff that I do on the front page, aside from maybe going into more intermediate knowledge of how to create widgets. And that's what you're doing right now with your feed over here on the side, which I'm doing.
Yeah, that's pretty cool.
And I'll talk about those a little bit. So these are basically pre-made and freely available. In fact, they might even call them widgets as well.
Mm-hmm.
That you can find online and basically just copy and paste the code into a custom widget. Now, a custom widget is just a content box that V2L gives you. And what I've done here is I've just taken, if I go in here, HTML, to paste the code into it. But Feedzilla is a company that allows you to customize and create RSS feeds of various terms and search terms and usernames and things like that that have to do with all sorts of things. I'm actually searching Twitter right now for what I'm getting my information from. But when you generate a widget at Feedzilla, they give you this code. And all you have to do is copy it from Feedzilla, paste it into a custom widget here, and then of course save it, and that's what creates, when we go back here, of course, this widget here that actually just dynamically is always pulling from RSS, in this case, RSS feeds pertaining to video games. And if we watch long enough, you'll see that this fills up with different music codes. Those are clicking out to actual news items about those things that come up in the news feed. I get a very similar thing from the Flickr.com website. They have a way to generate a widget based on keywords and things that you do. This is the Flash widget, so this relies on the entities or having Flash player installed. It will also pop up one of those annoying, if you're using Windows, one of those annoying, you want to show dynamically created content, you know, you have to say yes or no, depending on the operating version of the browser community. But anyway, these are images, again, that are pertaining to video games, and if you click on any one of these images, it will take you out to, Flickr and show you what it is. And like that. It looks like you created some sort of mold for So that's how that was created. And once again, if I go to edit this widget, it's exactly the same. I can go to edit HTML source. And this is, it's longer, but this is all generated by Flickr. I didn't write any of this. I just copied it at Flickr and pasted it here in HTML. And it automatically shows up like this on the website. There's a lot of different companies that create widgets like this.
For example, what are some other ones?
I don't know off the top of my head, but I mean, if I go out here to Google and do something like RSS feed widget, let's say.
There's a big one.
RSS feed widget. RSS include, feedzilla, there's one we're using, widget easy, so there's
Oh, I might find one, something like that then. Okay.
I think there's even like Facebook, I think.
So the idea,
go ahead.
You find the RSS feed you want, then you go to feedzilla to get the code, or?
I'll show feedzilla right now because it's fairly simple.
You know what, it's just their WordPress. I'm thinking that WordPress then, you could really customize it. If they have their own feed, because you could do a lot of different things in WordPress, and then they have the code for you to use whatever you set up.
Right, put it somewhere else, yeah.
Interesting.
One of the things, too, like a lot of if you are using a more professional blogging system like WordPress or any of the other ones, they generate automatically an RSS feed.
Okay.
And so you could take that feed and put it into a widget.
There you go, yeah.
So all I have to do here is build my own news feed. You get it the widget you dial, they have a slide left to right, slide top to bottom, or ticker. In fact, if you change it here, it will change it here on the side, or up here on the top. So this would be one you might put in the header of your, if you want to show it. Country source, you can choose, I think, all English, or you can choose specific areas. Categories. Let's say I want to do a search term, and I want it to be biology. Update the preview. And it's loading. It might not be in my Oh, there we go. Unborn baby safe toxic chemical onslaught has some DNA. Okay. There's also some other tabs here appearing in advanced, so you can actually change the look of your widget a little bit. And then when you grab the code, that's all it does. It gives you this box, it copies everything that's in it. So I'm going to do Control A to select all. Control C, and then I can paste that into my widget.
So what if, like, the RSS change?
Yeah.
Could I?
And that, that's sort of what we were talking about earlier.
It's
definitely possible, but you probably have to either find a canned widget that allows you to insert RSS URLs, or use a little JavaScript to create a custom RSS feed thing, which isn't really difficult, but it's more gas than most instructors will want to get into here. So, if there's a high enough demand, I mean, it wouldn't take me long to build like a generic RSS feed.
Well, and if you wanted to, like in yours, you want it from a specific website that you know is good. Mm-hmm. For me, I want to build my own because I want certain. But I do use this too because this is just generic psychology and it's still very useful and fun for the students to have.
So it would be the same thing though if I built a generic feed aggregator. You would put your URL in.
Yeah.
So that's stuff that I do on my main page. Trying to think if I do anything else here. I usually don't. I will
put a game in your news.
it was like almost similar to posting embed code from YouTube or something. So yeah, there's depending on where you're getting your code from. Sometimes it's easy to embed as a YouTube video. Sometimes it takes a little thought. So there are some fun things you can do if you do choose that.
Speaking of embedding YouTube videos, actually, one thing that I've noticed that a lot of our instructors do is we're really focused on the link And so in content, there's a lot of links to YouTube videos. There's a link to an telecom video or something like that. You can actually embed telecom videos. You can embed the YouTube video. You don't have to send students to the link. So that would be something that I'd like to see happening, or seeing telecom or YouTube video actually in a widget or interview. Yeah. Or you could put it in a content item surrounded by text. So you could have, you know, part of your lecture, if it's written lecture, lecture notes, and then you can have a YouTube video of, like, say it's a hybrid class, and you cover this video in class, and then you can actually have it embedded into that content page rather than through the link. And another thing that a lot of instructors do is, like, they'll have the lecture refer to the video, and then there's a separate topic in B12 that's the link. So you could start integrating, making it simpler for students to kind of help with retention, and help with the experience. And so integrating those videos together kind of like helps.
And then they probably do it in one of these clips. Here's one where we have that just right in it.
Okay.
I basically have a blurb from a news article that refers to the video. And what will happen is a lot of times these news articles will have links to the video. And so I'll go straight to the video myself and get the embed code there rather than just putting it on here. So you can see, all of these have different images and things.
So when you do that from YouTube, because YouTube has an option, it says embed, and they give you two different ones. One is something like long and one is short. And I think I read, because I've done it in a couple, there's a particular way you have to do it, isn't there? Or just whatever code they give you?
Yeah. So let's go to so you go to
share.
Mm-hmm. This will just get you the link, but there's also a button frame there.
Right, and then there.
So here, there's a couple of ways you can do this. There's the iframe method, which basically inserts their content through. An iframe is almost like looking through a window.
Oh, okay.
And so their website is actually in your website.
Oh, that's interesting.
You can also use the old embed code.
Because that's what I think I had read, that you have to use the old embed code, at least for PowerPoint or something, or you
Yeah, for PowerPoint.
Yeah.
Yeah. Well, PowerPoint is not a web-enabled application, so iframes don't work. So you have to use the object, which is linking, you know, basically, embedding the video on your page.
Right?
Yeah. You're not actually downloading it, so it's a.
And I'll always, like, usually I'll actually create a custom clip. You know, like, I'll do something like 350. Because I know that's typical, too. I use a lot of 350 as, like, my default image width that I use. Okay. My news post is always nice and clean.
Do you know anything about those other checkboxes here?
But there is always something that you can check on most videos now that, I'm trying to think if there's a reason. A lot of videos now will either will have or they won't have the subtitle option. And I always try to find, like, if I look for a video like this and something this is exactly the video I want, which is not, of course, and it doesn't have the subtitle option, I'll take a few minutes to search that exact title and see if I can find a video with a subtitle option. So,
because that meets ADA requirements to do that? Okay.
Well, technically subtitles don't, but it's way closer, way better to some version. And there is captions too. So there's subtitle versions, there's captions versions, and so looking for either is a good idea. Okay, so you're saying you just take a minute to
look at another video.
That's a good best practice for me.
So let's see, go back to...
I have another question about the YouTube video. So the old embed code, is that not going to then, because if students watching the video and when the YouTube video finishes, there's like screenshots of other videos?
You can update the checkbox now. You can say show recommendations or not show recommendations.
So which was better of those two options, the old embed code or the top?
I think the old code still uses the flash code. The new code uses HTML5 video, which is something that you don't have to have that. Well, you have to have a modern browser. But you don't have to have the flash player, and it doesn't pop up that you want to load in as content.
Okay.
All right, so I'm going to flip over to my content now, where I just have a few pages that I'm going to show. The first one is things that we can all do to make our content look nicer. The other ones are a little more advanced, and in fact, one of them was so advanced that it took me like 5 days to figure out the button that was happening on it. But it's really cool, and it shouldn't, it's not the fact that the what I did was difficult, it was the fact that D2L is deleting something every time I create the post, they would mess it up. And so I wanted to figure out how to fix it. Anyway. So one thing I do, and I don't know if everyone does this, but I really am a fan of using the new file option for all of your content. So this is, you know, basically like an HTML page or a blog post. So all of my content for every course that I do is not a PDF file, it's not a Word doc, it's not anything, it's all right here. And one of the great things about that is people with screen readers, it's just like reading a web page and they'll just read the content. Likewise, you don't have to rely on people having certain software. So I know a lot of them start to do that anyway.
How does that work? What does that look like if you had like a PDF file?
If you go to the topic, you can either upload a new file, or you can, you know, use something in your course files or equipment or something. And
So what I do is I understand that for most things, but when I have my lectures, I always upload the PDF of the PowerPoint, all the slides ahead of time. Mm-hmm. I can't cut and paste PDFs, though, into an HTML file.
No.
Of my PowerPoint.
I approach this differently than probably most people because I started teaching online before I started teaching on ground.
Mm-hmm.
All of my content was already in content files, and so when I started putting the PowerPoints for my classes, I copy and paste it from here.
Now
whenever I update a PowerPoint, I make sure that I come back here and update my content.
Well, it is a best practice to start considering moving content that is in some sort of proprietary to move it from that type of a format into actual pages, because to start thinking of, this is an online course, PowerPoints don't necessarily make sense.
No, I'm not talking about online courses, though. I'm talking probably the same thing. I'm talking about courses where it's web-enhanced course. It's completely different.
To answer that question, all I have to do is show you a web-enhanced course, like in my connection. And you'll see that I do the same thing. So these are all in my PowerPoints here.
Okay, so no, my recommendation was more for teaching online, and you're encouraged to start morphing that. I mean, you may not the first few semesters because it's new, but, you know, start morphing that content into an actual Desire2Learn page and building it out.
I understand that it might look better, but otherwise, pedagogically, what's the reason for that? If you're a completely online course, why would it really matter if it's in a PDF or as a web page? Other than maybe for student access, is it easier for them to access it that way?
There's a couple of things. So one is if you upload a file, you're then requiring students to download the file. I mean, sometimes you have a viewer that you could see it in a tab. It depends on your browser. It depends on whether it's working. It depends on their file type, your file type, et cetera.
But a PDF is pretty much universally...
I'm using it as an example, but actually no. Because Adobe, if you notice, Adobe's constantly updating all the time. And so one student hasn't updated their Adobe whatever, or they're on a computer that doesn't allow for updates or whatever it may be. So PDFs are okay. It's just and I'm not even just talking about PDF Word, whatever file type you're using, whenever you're using some sort of external file type, it needs extra steps, extra things to do, extra ways to see it. So that's one issue. Another thing that Tim already brought up is that one way to think of it is it's easier for someone that's all in the system, and he was saying also screen readers are just going to read it on the web page. So, for instance, the best practice if we were to be developing a web page, and that's actually what all of Desire2Learn is, and I'm starting to explain that more, is everything's a web page. That's what this is. Instead of you building your own web page, Desire2Learn is giving you like the structure to build web pages with. So when I'm doing more part college.edu things, it's better for me to, instead of just plopping a PDF in there, it's actually better for me to somehow recreate it. If it's really important information, it's better for me to recreate it rather than put a flyer in or something like that. It will work. It's just that there's extra steps. We're going to have an Adobe Acrobat Reader, which isn't that hard to require. 2 minutes free, you know, but they have to update it. If there's
just for efficiency, basically, yeah, okay.
Considerations, but any other things?
No, I just have two anecdotal responses, one being that even in our math lab, we had a situation where, you know, Macintosh comes with Preview, which is this ongoing PDF reading application. But for some reason, we didn't have Acrobat installed at the time, but the file type was set to, like, while the normal Mac user will say, oh, I'll just open it in Preview, every time people were getting PDF files in that lab, they have no idea what to do because they double click on it, which they can't open. So it was a big kind of issue in that regard. The other one was, I don't know all of the reasons behind it, but I had a partially blind student who downloaded the syllabus, which was a PDF, and I got an email back from his mom saying, my son will not be able to take your course if everything is in PDF form.
Why? Well, you couldn't adjust the size of the screen,
yeah,
or something like that,
yeah,
whereas
yeah.
The web page you can. So I'm thinking about printing out web pages, though. Your example of your syllabus is a good one. Printing out, if they're printing out things that you put up there, it's going to be a different, am I right or wrong? I mean, because I haven't printed out things on the web pages for a while.
Pretty.
But it's not going to be as pretty or, you know, otherwise. So, okay, well, good rationale. Okay, thanks.
So let's say I have like a PowerPoint as a PDF file, and I have very image-heavy PowerPoints as well. How do I do that? Like, how do you logistically make that?
I would think of if I really had to think in those terms, which when I come to B2L, I try not to because I know I can't do something like that. But if I had to, every page in B2L would be the final page. You know how, you know, in a PowerPoint you sometimes have bullet points that's appearing and things like that. Whatever the final page is that shows all of the bullet points and the image and everything, I would make that a page.
Okay.
You know, so I'd upload an image, it might be smaller than this in the PowerPoint, you know. I'd have the bullet points, and so they can, it's basically like, you know, looking through a static PDF, except,
you know. But the endpoint is not actually what you're saying. Sort of makes sense because that's how they're viewing the content. Like, you go to view content and they start looking at it, you're actually going through what looks like slides.
Yeah.
So go ahead and click on one of those, and then you have the arrows on it. So this slide would be scrolling, but you actually have the way that you use it in there.
Yeah.
You have to have a pretty solid working knowledge of HTML then, in order, because you're doing that. You're not working within the HTML editor.
No, I'm working within the regular.
Okay. But there's no. So I would be like reinserting all the images all over again, and then cutting.
Yeah.
The summer job.
In fact, I recently added a section to my game design class based on something I did on the ground, and it was like, and I did that. I went from PowerPoint to there, and what I did is in PowerPoint is you can save an image out, you know, export image from PowerPoint. So I would save it out, import it into B2L. You can't copy and paste the text. You can do that. And it's just for one section. It's like, okay, I just wasted an entire day. You know, but, and, you know, at least it's done.
Because I have PowerPoints that are like more than 50.
Oh, yeah. No,
wow.
Exactly.
Wow.
Well, so just keep in mind one extra thing that we didn't talk about. You don't have to load full, we may have talked about this before. You don't have to load full PowerPoint files up. You can save as PowerPoint shows. And students don't have to have a PowerPoint program on their computer. So you can save as PowerPoint shows, the file type that they allow you to save it as, and then you're leaving your course and it's a much smaller file type, and that's one benefit, so I recommend this to course to users all the time. The other option is, and this keeps coming up, but it's not completely related, informing students that they can purchase free open source software, OpenOffice and LibreOffice. It's LIBRE, and they allow you to open up PowerPoint and look at things in there. So even if you're not going to put your PowerPoint in, I'm not telling you guys to do that. it's just that in terms of best practice, like say this was an actual web page, you wouldn't be just putting PowerPoint slides up. You would be trying to recreate it into this kind of format and building it into the site instead.
But you couldn't print it. When you say save it as PowerPoint show, they can view it but not print it, though. So you sort of get the notes aspect of it.
But I can't answer all those questions.
Yeah.
So you just want to, all you have to do is save it as one file type and see what
And see what happens. Yeah, absolutely.
And also Google Docs will import it.
Yeah.
That
would be great.
And not to kind of go too far afield, but just out of curiosity, I've been playing with Prezi a little bit, which probably is not going to fit any of these things, right?
You think it's embedded, Prezi?
Oh, you, like, okay, you embedded, but okay, so that would be actually for an online course when you're actually looking at
it. The only thing else is Prezi at this point is not accessible on your phone, so.
Oh, okay, okay. Oh, okay, yeah.
I'm not pushing it, but.
Yeah, I really wish they would change that. And really, all they would have to do is take your text and, like, you know, put it in a plain text file.
Yeah,
but anyway.
Yeah.
So
you think like one PowerPoint slide would be a page?
Yeah.
And then
well, yeah, but the culmination of all of leading up to that one page, you know, I mean, I definitely wouldn't like say, what are the, you know, the terms for this particular subject, bullet point one, click to see the next bullet point, click to see the next bullet point. That's what every bullet point
is. Yeah, it depends on how you're doing your PowerPoint.
So, okay. So, I don't have much time left, but I want to talk about sort of what I did here.
This clock is wrong, just FYI, I just learned that.
Okay, so
I was freaking out with the meeting before this, and thinking we had no time to really, and it turned out it was wrong.
Yeah. So a couple of things, also, you know, I forgotten that they do have this print button above.
Oh, yeah. Okay.
So
yeah.
Okay.
You can print all of
the computer button. Okay. Usually you can hit a preview button and actually see what it looks like.
Well, maybe when you actually print it, it'll show it. Sometimes it'll show that first before you.
Yes.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
So, you can print almost everything you need. Almost.
Great.
So most of the stuff in this page is stuff that anyone can do.
Yeah.
And I just had some best practices that I use in order to at least pretty up my pages a little bit. It's really simple to go in and type it. You know, I'm going to do it right now. I'm going to go to content and say, new topic, and give it a name. Test. And I can say, you know, this is my content. And save it. And when I go back to view content, you'll see that it's the final section within this module. And I'll click on it. We'll see what it looks like. So even though my edit box showed a sans serif font like Arial or something, it's probably Tahoma. When I'm viewing it in the viewer, it's a serif font, Times New Roman. Now this is all based on the default settings that the user has input into their D2L settings. Okay? By default, my font is Times New Roman. So one of the things that I'm saying in this first section here is use the fonts. If you want your course material to look consistent to every user, set a font. And so what I've done here is I've actually set my font to Arial, which is in the pull-down menu, and I say only use available fonts because those are the fonts that every computer in the world will have. Okay. I increased the point size to 12 points, and that what this means is that every single person that looks at this content will see exactly this. Doesn't matter what their defaults are because I've overridden their defaults with my own font setting. Also make sure that you use the format pull-down menu to set headings and other paragraph styles, which is what I've done here, all of my headings. These are all paragraphs, these are all heading free, I think I've used. Not only is this important for making your content look nice, but it's in ADA compliance. And so another thing it does is also automatically format for me. In fact, if I'm going to edit this, you'll see that there's no other language. My paragraphs automatically, when I hit enter, have that space between them. And same with my headings. Automatically. So now that the paragraphs have, so what I'll do is come up here to format pull down menu. Select heading 3, automatically makes it full. So it automatically sets the spacing.
It's kind of I'm finding that it's a fast way to make things look nicer than if you did it on your own.
Not sure that's consistent.
And I was going to say consistent because you explained to me beautifully why when I've done this, then I go to look at it, and half of it has a different font, and I didn't do that.
Yeah.
You know, kind of something. And so there you go. That's terrific advice. Thank you. Another one you do this summer.
Yeah. Another thing is, again, with images, simply by using the alignment tools, you can sort of set your images to look nice throughout your document. In fact, I set this to align right, which automatically allows the text to wrap around it. And I think that looks a lot better than having, like, sometimes you'll see a text box with words coming out the bottom of it, or sometimes you'll just see an image with, you know, the text on the bottom. And so I like embedding my images a little more within the content to make it look nice. Some skills you might invest in, again, is image editing and some HTML and CSS, so you kind of know how to resize these images with loading the tech. This is a JPEG that I resized to a specific size in Photoshop, and I set it for 70% compression, and then the resulting file size is something like 3K, and so when someone loads this page, it's going to So again, resizing images within D2L is problematic. You can resize, but by dragging the little corner handle, so you know you're by the little corner handle. If you do that, hold the shift key, and that will allow you to resize an image proportionally and not squash it and stretch it. So the shift key is really important. And again, resizing images in D2L does nothing to reduce file size. If you upload a 5 megabyte file, resizing it will leave it 5 megabytes, and it'll still take a long time to download. Another thing you can do is use helpful iconography. So think like a textbook. I actually found this little question mark on Google Images, and you know, if you ever have something that is a pullout for some special information for someone to read, these little icons can really help sort of call that information out.
I'm sorry, where did you see we got those?
For Google Images.
Okay.
I just searched for question mark.
Okay.
And, you know. Tables. So I use tables in my Word Teacher widget on the front page. But you can also use them to help with your formatting. In fact, this is a table right here. What I did is created a two-column, one-row table. I'll show it to you in a second. And I put the image on the left column and the text on the right column. And that actually allows me to format really nicely, like the text isn't wrapping around the icon and it's being pushed out to the right a little bit. So if I go into here, you'll see that table right there. So you can see the borders of the table. And I put the text on one side and the image in another. And that helps create some nice formatting. Styles. I made my images actually look a little nicer, I think, by creating a white, a black border. The images actually also have a white background, and I'll talk about that in a second. What I've also done here, which you may notice, if I go to text, my content is on a white background. And sometimes it's really difficult to tell the difference between your content and your navigation on the left. And so what I did is I basically just changed my my page's background color. Light gray. And actually, that's a web best practice as well. Web designers say that you should never have anything that's pure white or pure black because it strains the eye.
Mm-hmm.
And so pure black, while it works, you can always set it to something just a little less than pure black. And I set this to a light gray instead of a white. That makes reading a little easier.
Can I ask a stupid question? In the student view, do they not see the bars at the top link? All those icons along the top.
They see that
too, okay.
They don't see the edit.
So everything except the edit.
They look pretty like a bookmark. That's what that little pink thing is. That's a cool feature that as an instructor role, you don't usually, you don't even know you're good.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. And it's pretty cool. It makes you bookmark their, things they want to go back to. So they do have some more options for me for this out.
So make sure you set your alt tag. So if you hover your mouse over an image and it doesn't say anything, then probably something's wrong.
So is there an option when you insert your image for doing an alt tag right there?
It automatically gives you a text box.
Okay, great.
And you do all the course, but it's another thing to be made, right?
And so another image that I put, I center aligned this image. So you can see the difference between some of the ways that images can be aligned within your content. And so this page really is one of those things that, I mentioned why I gave this image a white background. It was so that it wouldn't pop off the gray background and look like a prank. And so that's kind of a neat way to kind of beautify, the things that you put on the website. So this page really is one of those things that most of the stuff I've done here is easily accomplishable by any of our instructors. Some of the difficult stuff would be creating the border around the image, and a gray background, actually. Let me show you how I get a gray background out of this, because you'll see that it's not as easy as it might seem. So I also have an embedded style here that tells us to give the background color of the body a gray. And so you can see that in the head section. And now, this is actually a good way to segue to the next page of the presentation I'm doing here. One of the great things about, one of the great and difficult things about D2L, as you create these sort of web-based content pages, they are complete websites, or web pages that get delivered again through an iframe, and which is the way that the new YouTube embed works. So what you're doing is actually saving out HTML files. In fact, if I go to my files, and I've got a bunch of stuff here, but you'll see that I've got index.html, pop-up HTML, tooltips HTML. These are all, there's my test one that I just created. These are complete self-contained web pages. And because of that, you do have access, unlike the widgets.
You can see it from the name of the title, too.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, you can see it.
Right on top of that
HTML. There we go. It's called prompt underscore. And that's actually really accessible. When you create a name, it'll automatically come up with an HTML name for you. And so I'll shorten it so that I can like remember what they are. So anyway, yeah. So anyway, this does give you access to all of the entire, you know, the entire web page, which allows you to do some really advanced stuff, like put things in the head section and add other things that I'll show next. All right, so I'm going to go on to the image pop-up page. And this, now I'm going into territory that I would wager no instructor here would be able to figure out. So if you want to do something like this, ask me. It's not really hard. It just takes a little tinkering.
Yeah, and you can also, yeah, you can email him and say, how'd you do that? And you probably get a direction.
Yeah, oh yeah, for sure. So if you're a little more technically inclined, you can actually embed images and create image galleries and really create pop-up windows that don't rely on extra or on adding new browser windows. So I have a bunch of images here, or three images, as well as a text link, and I'm going to show you what they do. So I'm going to click on this image, and you'll see that it actually pops the image up right into the window.
Oh, yeah.
And each of these images is part of a gallery. So I can actually use these arrows now and scroll through them.
Your own code, or you borrow code?
Oh, this is all, yeah, jQuery is a JavaScript library, and there's a lot of different, so it's a little bit of both. So,
yeah, for someone like me, I don't build code ever. I use, like, you know, the copying, like, you're saying, and I can mess with it a little. Just enough to mess with something like a color, I know how to do that.
And so,
I would only be far, if I were to pull this off, I'd say, okay,
when
this one's him, I'm
going to
go find something where I can
grab
code.
Yeah.
I'm not going to actually write it.
Yeah, I'll show you what that code looks like in a second, but that's a gallery. You can also apply the same thing to the text link. So if I wanted the text link to be an image.
They actually just pop up as well.
And you'll see that while these three clouds, you'll see one out of three is in this gallery. I actually gave a new class name to this link, and that makes it its own gallery. And so since there's only one image in that link, it's not part of the previous gallery. So so that's one really cool thing you can do. Now the code itself, you'll see it's fairly complex, and you've got to import a bunch of JavaScript files, and then you have some actual JavaScript here. And, you know, I mean, there's some interesting things you have to do with them. The next thing, actually, I think is probably even more useful for some people. Probably requires the same amount of skill as these pop-up windows, but it works really quickly within V2L. I didn't have to do any bug testing or anything like that. So these are sort of pretty cool tips that can help to add additional information to your test that they are accessible. The cool tips, meaning that a screen reader will read them, even if we can't see them here. And so, for example, in terms of a biology class, one might inform students that air is allowed into a person's lungs via their skin. So if I hold my mask over that, and it's actually a whole lot of more information about the trade view.
This is something that Eliza uses soft chalk for.
Right.
Yeah.
I just did say that.
One
yeah.
of her favorite features of soft chalk, and why she uses it is because it does things.
And I remember her presentation thinking myself, "Oh, that rings."
Let's see, but that's the advantage of soft chalk. That and a million other things. The only problem is, see, I think that we applied, I forget where we applied, to get a group license for that, but I don't know that we did or not. I mean, so it's
not officially. Yeah.
This year, yeah. I mean, yeah, and so, and she just got it because, you know, she's new and we want her to have something like that. But.
So the other example just had to do with an image. I said if you had an art history class or something, you could always do a self-assessment within your content and ask some questions. What is the title of the painting? Who's the painter? When was the painting? Underneath it says hover over the image and
do
the
answers.
So I'm going to hover, and then after 2 seconds, it actually tells you the answer. So, you know, I mean, something that's just, if students really want to test their knowledge and see if they understand what's going on. And so
are you using this in your, like, just... right now?
Yeah, this is ongoing too. This one, like I said, I'm going to recreate one of my classes over the summer, and it actually uses a textbook now, so I'm going to do a lot of reference to the textbook in this sort of functionality. All right, so the next thing I'm going to show is the thing that caused all sorts of problems. That took me a few days to figure out. But it's what's called there's a number of names for it, either a content slider or a content carousel or various other things. And, and so this is another way to present images with it'll actually scroll through all of the images automatically. Each of the images has a description. I can also click on each of these and go to them. And then these descriptions can even have links to, you know, other websites. And so I thought that was a cool way to present maybe a number of images, you know, within one slide and sort of let them, you know, rather than having to go through several pages or having images take up your content space, allowing students to see all of them in one slide.
So I would think there's programs out there that would do this for you, but they probably cost money.
Well, this is the program that does it for you.
No, you're the program that does it for you. You're the one who puts in the code to do it.
Web technologies.
Oh, they are? Oh, okay. Okay. This isn't some code you've come up to do that. You've actually inserted some, you found a little program.
Well, no, it's code that allows you to extend what happens within an HTML page.
Oh, okay.
And so it's not like an external program or
it isn't.
Like
okay.
But it allows you to do some things that sort of are kind of look flashy and you know, keep the interest. And this is something I have used in a previous version of E2L when it didn't mess it all up. This is something I did use for a little while in one of my classes to show screen grabs of different video games, you know,
so kind of just your question actually though, the thing that I would do, because I'm a hack, I guess, is I would get the code, like I know that he made this,
mm-hmm.
I would get the code for it, and I would just find the image link.
Right.
Yeah.
And plug it in, yeah.
I would just change it for myself.
It's actually really simple to do that. If you're comfortable, that's what kind of why I keep talking about, you know, at least learning a little HTML.
Yeah.
So that you can look through this and see, okay, well, here is a link, AHRFMS, a link,
yeah.
And here's an image embed, IMG source, which is image source. There's the link to the actual
page. And with your own images, you don't struggle so much because you're
your own image,
and you're
going to go,
oh, there's that thing.
And you'll see that I put all of these basically, like, this is the link to my file section for this particular course. I made an images folder, and I put all of the images in that image folder.
I had to learn a few times. I don't know if anyone else, I found when I was cutting and pasting from Word, I had, like, imported questions that I was modifying, and there was all this, like, crap in there. And it was doing weird, and the only thing I could find that fixed it, I had to just go into the HTML editor. But that's the extent of my knowledge, getting rid of the junk. And
there's
then,
a paste as text button here.
That's not working for me, though.
And I've heard that before.
It works in
Word.
Works for
me. Paste
that used to work.
And then we'll do it, and then it gets to the hot fix, so you can always try to see if things are working again. And then we'll do an upgrade, and then see if that's working. anyway. And yeah, the issue with this one was he had to go in, he kept screwing it up, and he had to go in and find this one thing. He kept, what was it, deleting or something?
He was deleting his curly brace. And, well, here's the weird thing about it is I would expect a program like Desire2Learn to attempt to validate all of the code that instructors write because they want it to not break D2L, right?
Sure, yeah.
But it was actually deleting something arbitrarily, completely outside of validation. And so, yeah, it was, I actually figured out that if I put one more than I needed, it would delete the extra one. And, I mean, that's, I couldn't find a way to know how that
You have to go through Mark.
Yeah.
We are not supposed to contact you.
Yeah, I don't know. But he didn't seem to.
We're being
recorded.
So, well,
I've gotten... No, not that far.
Yeah. Yeah. No, I think that some things, it's just not high priority. Yeah. And so he knows, because we've learned the suggestions so far.
Sure.
You know, and so that's why I like the conference last year. And now they're coming out with version 10, and that is incorporating user-friendly and a better look.
Are they ever going to fix the discussion groups?
Great. Thank you.
What do you mean, Rachel? What is the discussion?
So I have my discussion, I break them into discussion groups because I usually have like a cross-listed section.
Yes.
And so let's say I have like discussion number one, group one, discussion number one, group two. It won't let me link that to the same grade item in D2L.
Oh.
So I can't, because I need to do click open. Grade, click open, rather than going to an external spreadsheet. So what my fix to it is to make the second group create that as a bonus item, and then you're basically creating an extra column, which either has the points. And I say, I even put in my syllabus, this is not extra credit.
But they still don't get it.
Yeah. But yeah. This time of year, I'll get emailed being why am I getting the extra credit?
Yeah, right, absolutely.
And then I cut and paste that part of the syllabus. I explained this in orientation, it's not a bonus. And but it works as a fix, except that it confuses students.
I'm glad to know that, because I don't do groups, and I was considering it, and I won't. Thank you. Because I found that the other things are... because the grading issue. Grading issue for me is a big issue. And in other areas, too.
And it's not a horrible workaround. I'd be happy to show you my shell, and then,
Yeah, it's a workaround, but anything that confuses students, because they don't, you can repeat things ad nauseum, but they need to have it, right, they see that right away, so, yeah.
There's a few things that you can do if you're concerned, it depends on your concern, and you're concerned about confusing students, then you could do this, or you could
curate,
you can actually hide the column, and
it's
There are always things, I had an online student turn up yesterday, actually, and I was who are you? And I'm like, you're online, so I don't know. He was my grade is out of 445, and my friend's grade is out of 455, and I was that's because someone didn't take a quiz. So it got dropped. And they were like, what's up with you as an instructor? Why are we...
Oh, my gosh.
Yeah, there are always things that are going to...
That's pretty much, the more you try, the more...
But it would be nice if they could create a fix for that, because I do like having the groups.
It's not really a fix. It's more that they want to redesign, and I'm wondering if it's possible. So the version 10 of D2L is a redesign. Something being consistent online page and at the stage of here, the trash cans there, and the stage of those things, that's what the redesign is. So it's possible, with either one or two things, so those are at least a little cleaner or be a little bit easier to use, but then they had to redesign in order to make some of those things that drive us nuts. They had to redesign in order to allow those changes to happen. So it's possible that after version 9 to say that it isn't a fix, now they'll be able to use some of those things for it to become integrated.
Kind of like, if you had complaints about the calendar before, they probably were going, we know. And now they've come up with this new calendar, so now it's completely redone, and it was probably because of all the different pieces of feedback that they could integrate those. So we'll see what happens.
Speaking of the calendar, I've had some really weird occurrences lately where assignments that have due dates are appearing 4 or 5 times.
And I think I'm probably getting that too. I don't look that closely.
Well, I have to. They're what are we doing?
I send the information. I send you, okay, then this course, if this assignment looks this way, you're good at that. But I mean, just for everyone at large, if you give me details rather than an email of it's always looking weird, or it's weird, tell me exactly what you're seeing so that I can, and before,
before you, quote, fix it. Because what happens is 2 months later, someone says, this isn't working, and this happened to me one day. But then if I can't look at it that way, and then I'll say, oh, well, let me see, though, will you fix that? You know, or we can find out what's going on. And then the person will say, well, I really don't believe it. Okay, well, it's really weird. Yeah, but so anyway, you know, so stopping and telling you is great. We are speaking of which there are a few issues happening with the assignment Dropbox right now. Mm-hmm. So, and I thought that some things were fixed or getting fixed, and they were all elevated. They were all at once. Mm-hmm. So those were all elevated at each level. And so those are thinking of suggestions or little things that don't really...
The issue with the students actually submitting things and it not appearing was it, because I get that a lot.
No.
Are you really? Oh.
No, it was not this semester. No, it was on our end. As an instructor, you go to the assignment and things weren't showing. One instructor was clicking on, like, if someone was... And he was bouncing them back to the list.
I don't even know.
No one else reported that, but I verified it. She tried it on multiple computers.
You know what? I think that happened. You said it didn't happen the second time, so I figured it was something I did, but I think I remember that happened.
Yeah, she did multiple computers, multiple browsers. That's the way to test, too. If something's being funky, jump to something else first to see if it's an actual issue, or if it's just, okay, I don't know why this browser's doing that today. Well, anyway, so, we're out of time, but can anything drop up? Or?
No, that's it. So if you guys
great, thank you. I'm glad you had time to do this.
Yeah, thank you so much. Really
yeah, I was going watching stuff.
Yeah, thanks. I learned things, too.
speaking of browsers, I just recently had this with Firefox when I was looking through their discussions, or that maybe it's the new Firefox, but I couldn't save on it, so I had to. Is that a new thing about Firefox? Have you noticed that? Like the little pop-up window of the discussions when you're seeing all the posts that they've done, there was no save option in the bottom of it. Isn't that weird? And I thought, what's wrong with this? And then said, I could. So I don't know. On Firefox, just like within the past week, when I went to assess a discussion, and the assessment, just going through student discussion box, and then of all the posts that they've done.
Yep.
And on the bottom of that, there's a save button, you know, obviously.
Yep.
And it wasn't there. None of that was there. And I just, you know, Firefox just updates itself constantly, and so I figured there was something there. But kind of odd, and so...
I have switched over to Chrome. I was a huge Firefox person, and I switched over to Chrome for right now, but then Firefox started slowing down my computer the past year.
Yeah.
So maybe they're just having problems.
But I don't know.
I feel bad for them.
Yeah.
I don't know what's going on. Maybe Google's just kind of wiped them out. I don't know. Have you been using Firefox at all anymore?
I have to for some classes I'm taking. Yeah. The only thing that gets these weird Java applets that they used to work for Valvoline, I use Safari.
You use what?
Safari.
Safari, oh, because you're a Mac. But Firefox is the only one that has a Zotero plugin, and so so I use Zotero constantly. Because again, I'm always looking for articles and saving articles. Zotero is a database, and it's a free one, and it's fantastic. It's like EndNotes, or what I use when I'm doing my dissertation, Ref Manager or something like that. But Zotero is a very large brand, and so who's the group that's behind it? I can't remember, the Annenberg Foundation or something. Maybe not, but. It's fantastic database management thing for doing research, and so I use it all the time. And they now have a standalone, and so you can go via Chrome by using a standalone. And but it's not nearly as cool as it's built into Firefox. So.
Built into Firefox.
And then they've even done little add-ins. You can put it into your iPad, and so it's actually it's very neat. So. You know, terrific. And, you know, I think it's excellent information. I do appreciate this. So.
I'm doing a lot of webinars and things in order to just find, and I'm just I'm taking in as much stuff as possible.
Yeah.
To dig and kind of keep track of things. It's just kind of, my records are a mess because there's so many things I'm trying to track and add.
Well, try Zotero. It tracks that too. And every web page, or most pages, will have a little icon at the top of it, again, using Firefox, so where you can automatically add something to your page if you want to, especially. Very cool. So, and being free, since I used to pay hundreds of dollars for this kind of thing.
Right, exactly. And you could have to be a part of a university in order to access resources.
Well, in order to access the actual data, that's true. But then you bought the database management stuff. Anyway, thanks so much, folks.
Thanks.
Bye.
Yeah.